So this all duties to all students. First, I'm the chair. My name is Hong Yiquan. My name is Hong Yiquan, and I'm from the National Taiwan Normal University. So the second jury is
Now let's start our competition.
So the first stage, the opponent will challenge the reporter for a problem. So you have 1 minute. Opponent.
Okay, so we would like to challenge question number four.
Question number four. So reporter, you have 1 minute. Consider you want to accept or reject.
Thank you.
Accept. So reporter, you have 5 minutes to prepare. And each team, please write down the, all your representatives on the blackboard.
Thank you.
review, please take the stage and present your report.
Okay, everyone, this is what we're going to present for the 603 ball, and our team is inside. The first is the problem. The problem is having two steel balls that are joined together and can be spun at incredibly high frequency by spinning them by hand and then blowing them on the fluid tube. For example, like a drilling trough, and then investigate this phenomenon. And things we'll be using later on are carbon abrasion and recession. Now, first is our experiment setup. Our equipment includes steel balls, drinking straw, adhesives, steel plate, and a camera. And this is our setup. And then first is our observation. Taking through this, we took this video through a high-speed camera, and through this, we get the observation that when it is just purely rolling, when it is stable, we can observe that it's purely rolling. And our theory for the experiment. You can see from this picture here. The Lagrangian equals kinetic energy minus the potential energy. When we open it, the equation, we get this, where the I is the angular potential energy, and the phi dot and the psi dot is the speed that they spin. We can get the velocity at the point of contact is zero when it is pure rolling. And also we can get through calculation, we can get that when the balls still slow, the theta dot is close to zero. Through the Lagrange equation, we can get that when we partial Lagrange by theta dot and then differentiate it by time, minus the Lagrange partial by the theta is equals to zero. In this situation, we can get that when we partial Lagrange by the theta equals to zero. And then after simplification, our theory is that the cosine theta is 2 over 5 minus g over radius times omega to the power of 2. And this is under the condition that it is pure rolling and there are no displacement. And the things that we neglected are the air drag. And next is our experiment. This is the result we get from the experiment. And this is the equivalent of a smaller ball. The circumstances are the radius being 0.5 centimeters and the mass being 14.1 kilograms. And this graph is run by sine theta to omega to the power of negative 2. And this is the line we get. The red line is the theory and the black line is rolling graph. The next is the big ball, with the red line being the theory and the black line being the result. Next is a phenomenon that we observe, possession. Now, we can't really observe this through the eye, but we still put this video because when we put it through tracker, we could see that there was a slight angular change where it goes up and down, which is the theta changing. That is what happens to the design. When we think that it is the result of the perpetual friction, but it is. Next is our. We have, from the graph, we can see that according to theory, at the end, it goes, the cosine is 2 over 5. And our result is close enough to the theory that we can think that would take that and follow it. But we think that the reason for the error is because of the thickness of the fluid. Because when we calculate it through theory, we use the radius of the ball that we have. But we stick it together with glue, and we think that increases the R, which causes the change. And we also think that the cosine theta gets closer to 2 over 5 when it is forward faster.
You have 2 minutes to answer the problem.
Would you turn this HDMI? What is no displacement? No displacement.
It means like, does it have any horizontal
band? Horizontal band in the center of mass.
Yeah.
Did you try to qualify how much torque you're giving to the system when it's spin
back?
Okay, so did you do any experiment as to when you're blowing up your ball?
Yep, the experiment was what's
going on the ball. Okay, so did you try like different velocities or different pressures, different pressure conditions? Did you try to manipulate the airflow coming out of the shore, which like different positions?
Well, because our experiment was done by us blowing it to a very high speed up so that we can increase it anymore and then we slow it down.
Okay.
We took the video of them slowing down.
Alright, okay. So you didn't discuss why it was left off when it was great.
Oh, we didn't. It's taken a long time.
Alright, I'm going on.
It gets when the speed gets higher.
Alright, so. Oh, did you try like different surfaces?
No, just
time's up.
Thank you.
Opponent, you have 3 minutes to prepare your challenge.
帮忙一下。
这个 switch 怎么切？现在好像连不上去。我要问一下。我们先等下暂停，那机器这样子。
Derivation
derivation of equations. Moving on to the setup. We have a clear experimental setup, and they do have a model setup correlation, which is them blowing onto blowing air onto the balls. However, for the cons part, they told us it was tracker, but they did not tell which point on the balls they did track, and they did not say other than the original spin of the balls, they did not say whether the ball was spin sideways or basically anything other than the main rotation phenomenon that's unseen. And so moving on to experiment, we did not hear anything about the connection between the balls and anything related to blowing through the straw. We did not get a clear setup. But we did get the statement of precession, which is quite a good observation. And lastly, we have the conclusion. So they have a matchup of their theory to the experiment and a quick and concise summary. However, we don't have a quick quantitative picture as to how, for example, how the number of friction on the surface or like how different surface will affect the phenomenon. And but they do have error discussion and how it corresponds to theory, which is really good. And so what they didn't do, they did not have an initial condition discussion. And this is critical to why as to why the ball would have come in the first place. They did not try different surfaces as it will probably affect the vibration. It will probably affect how the ball spins at steady state. And they did not quantify spinning by hand, nothing on straws. And they only observe one spin direction, which we think is not true. And that's it. So for the next one, we'll do a quick discussion. I'll have three question sets. The first one is why precession? And is there any other possibility of causing precession? And there's an experiment graph that we have a question about. And how is, the last one will be how it spins and lifts off. Okay, thank you. Okay. So, good afternoon. The precession part. Could you explain to me, under the math and physical means, as to why you think there'll be a precession around the axis? When it's lifted off, it should look like this, right? your rotational axis, correct? And so what is happening is this thing will rotate around that axis. Okay, so what force causes this axis to rotate around this one? What forces will cause this thing to spin around that? Moving on, you only observed in your video, you only observed the ball spinning this way, right? Is it possible that?
Yeah, we did put it over here.
Okay, so did you measure that in your experiment?
We put it in theory equation.
But you didn't measure it. So is it possible that this spin is causing the precession and that you're not observing it in your experiment?
No, we observed it.
You observed precession, but you didn't measure the spin. So you don't know the exact correlation between the spin and the precession. Alright? Okay, so I would like to do a quick short summary here. So what happened is that when asked about the initial conditions, the reporter said that they spun the ball when one side is already lifted off. That's the first thing that happened. And the second thing that happened is that the reporter, in their theory, they think that this spin will cause a precession. However, they didn't measure it in any way, and they didn't show us any correlation, which we think is completely uncalled for. Alright. Okay, so moving on, can I see your experiment graph? I'm not sure which one it is, so go through it. Next one. Okay. So as we see, the first point is above the red line and is above the red line, right? Yeah, so what do you think is causing that?
The red line is the dune.
Yeah, but the one you measured is the supposedly the black dots are supposed to be below the red line, right?
Yeah.
But the first black dot is above the red line. That is black, right? So why do you think the first black dot is above the red line?
It's simply a
number. Okay, so it's caused by clicking on the tracker or anything else? All right, okay, thank you. Good, so...
Did a question about, you didn't know which point you were tracking? Tracker?
Yes.
Yeah, we did track it, but we were tracking it anyway.
So, what is your point of reference?
That you are, the dot, the point of contact?
So supposedly, according to the theory, your ball is going to be spinning this way and this way.
Yes. Right?
So, you have to have some sort of marker on the ball for you to track it.
So, we pause on the video.
So, oh, alright, okay, I understand the question. So you use hand to click on the okay, so again, a quick summary. So what happened is that when there is an experiment that involved the theory line, the reporter concluded that to experiment errors. And one question on how they tracked their balls, they said that they used frame by frame, which I think is very hardworking. Right. You didn't do any experiments as to how the balls will spin on different surfaces, right? Do you think it is possible that because of theory the balls friction is along with everything, do you think it's possible that the surfaces will affect how the ball spins?
Or that obviously it will affect what we are only doing in our skill. That is what our experiment is about.
Okay, so in theory, what would happen if you do it on sandpaper, for example, where the you move the unit? What do you think will happen? Would you see more precision? Would it go and slow down quicker or anything?
Well, then obviously it will slow down quicker.
So,
what the overview, the overview of the equation would be.
So you mean that friction is heavily used in the theory, but
it wouldn't have any effect on the larger equation.
Yes, yes, I understand. So you use the Lagrange equation to draw the theory, correct? And but you didn't test any other variables in the theory. Except for J0. Let's call this neighborhood L. So only measure this one. So again, a quick short summary. So as we see in the reporter's theory, they have the use of friction as means of how the precession happens. However, we did not see any testing on this part. Did not test anything on their theory, which again we don't quite understand. Good. Okay. And so could we look at your observational video again? In this video, the pipe is slowly moving upwards, right? So when you did the experiment, is the pipe still moving upwards?
Well, because this is just for the video, but when we do the experiment, what we observe is that when it's speeding up and it's slowing down, the effect is symmetrical, but it's just that when we are blowing it, it is less stable. So from here, the video here is just because we are using it on a high-speed camera, so you can still see the flaw there. We just haven't moved it out of this frame. But what we did in the experiment was just that the speeding up and the slowing down was symmetrical. But slowing down doesn't have any outside forces. It is more stable. That's why we use
slowing down. Please start the discussion. The opponent, you have 1 minute to present the discussion.
All right, so the reporter has a very well drawn out theory. However, there are many different variables in the theory. However, we did not see any experiment on that part, as to, for example, how friction will affect it or how the other spin will affect it. There's no measurement whatsoever, and there's no testing whatever. And the only thing that measured is the big rotational spin, which is quite clear at that point. And however, we do see a lifting of the straw in the observational video, and I do not quite understand how that affects the experiment yet. But I guess that's all. Thank you.
Owen, please stand by your team. Do you you have 3 minutes to question the reporter and the opponent? Now let's move to the next stage. So, reviewer, you have 2 minutes to prepare your representation. You can start your assessment. You have 2 minutes to make the concluding remark.
Okay, so first question. So, first question. The question last you guys asked was to explain the position, and our answer is that the friction over with small movements in particular will have small oscillation. And the error between our theory and data. There is some small measuring error and theory error. For tracking through the tracker, we track it by hand, frame by frame, not putting each dot by hand. And for the surface, the time to lift when stable purely rolling, so there is no big friction effect to the experiment. And then the omega difference. The phi and psi omega, they are the same because the distance they roll are the same. That's why it stays stable.
And that concludes thank you for your presentation. Now let's move to the next stage. Do you have any questions for me?
Okay. I have a question for the reporters.
Could you please stand up?
Precession. So could you explain to me what is the definition of precession? The definition of precession.
So when an axis turns around another axis, the oscillation of the speed.
Oscillation of what?
Of the theta.
Oscillation of theta. Opponent. Okay, the definition of precession. It's a very basic question.
I think it's just, when it's lifted up, it's just this axis where it's hitting around that axis. Around the axis that is perpendicular to the ground.
And your, what's the definition of precession?
Mass will be closer to the one with the bigger mass, and so what we'll see is the balls will be rotating around the middle of the balls. It will be rotating around partially inside the ball. That's the first thing we'll see.
Mm-hmm.
And the second thing probably is that the lighter ball will always be lifted up because of the torque divided by friction, and that it's easier to lift up that way.
How about the precession?
You mean what would happen
mm-hmm.
if one of the balls were bigger? I think since it's spinning around closer to the other center of the ball, the precession will actually be bigger. Yes, I think the angle will be bigger.
How about you?
Actually, the other Joe is
another question for the reporter. I noticed that you only do two experiments, small bore and big bore. Okay. Opponent, do you do this experiment? Do you have other?
Yes, we did. So we tried two big balls, one big, one small, and two small balls, and different distance between the balls.
Okay, you have more parameters. Huh?
Yes.
Reviewer, do you have you done this experiment? What are your experimental conditions? You didn't do this experiment. Okay, thank you.
So now the scoring time. Opponent. 7, 6, 6, 4, 8. And the score for reviewer. 4, 4, 3, 3, 6.
My comment for the reporter, you have to do more comprehensive study. So probably the timing you like. And for the reviewer, you need to build your confidence. I think you are two numbers, right? Confidence. So I believe you are getting better for the
next round. Okay. Okay. So since everyone for the first round, then we have a 10 minutes break.
Okay.
And please change your second round of the fight. Now our reporter is Tenta. And opponent is Eureka, reviewer is Insight. For opponent, you can pick up the question for the reporter. Problem 9. Reject.
Reject.
Problem 17. What's that? So before that, you can prepare your representation. And each team, please write a representative on the blackboard. Let's move to the next step. Report, you can start your report.
Good afternoon, dear contributors. I'm a reporter from Team TYPT, and now I'm here listening to Policy 17, Obstacle Chain Reaction. There are four main parts in my report: introduction and observation, simulation and theory, experiment and conclusion. First, I'm introducing the introduction and observation. The problem statement states, wooden obstacle stitches can be joined together by slightly bending each of them so that they interlock in a so-called corrugated chain. When such a chain has one of its ends released, the sticks rapidly dislodge and the wavefront travels along the chain. Investigate the phenomenon. We believe that we should focus on how slightly are the obstacle sticks bent, how the wavefront moves, and investigating the phenomenon. In the reaction, the obstacle sticks are both into a covalent leaf chain and turn into a wave-like explosion or release. And these are the parameters we use. Now I'm introducing the simulation and theory. These are the two most significant differences we found, but they have opposite results in the same experiment. And these are two experiment videos. On the upper video, the height is almost unchanged. But in the lower video, the height gets higher and higher. And these are also experiment videos. For the right video, the popsicle sticks are released in the air. But in the left video, the popsicle sticks are actually released at a table. According to the reference in the experiment video, we've made two different kinds of models, the forward model and the reverse model. We believe that in the forward model, the previous one is covered by the following one, and the opposite in the reverse one. And this is the theoretical model we made. If we need to start the reaction, we have to release these particles. And since the popsicle sticks are symmetric model, so the first at this point are the same, and the first at this point are the same. The reason is 2F and 6F is because the torque at this point and this point will be the same. So it will be 1 to 3. And the reason why it's not 1F and 3F is because both the popsicle sticks at this spot will give elasticity, and so they will get two times of the elasticity. And in the forward model, it rotates anti-clockwise, and it rotates clockwise in the reverse model, and the opposite for the next popsicle stick. But what's special is in the reverse model, the popsicle sticks will be stopped by the next popsicle. So part of the energy will pass down to the next popsicle sticks and so on. So now I'm introducing a theory. There is elastic potential energy stored in the popsicle stick. And when the energy released, it will be turned into translational and rotational kinetic energy and gravitational potential energy. And we just neglect the translational and rotational energy for two reasons. First, because calculated a theoretical result from the gravitational potential energy, and it is similar to the result we did in an experiment. And also, it's hard to measure the rotational energies because the times it rotates of its each particle state is different. And for the elastic potential energy, we can see that in the formula, the UE stands for the energy, E stands for Young's modulus, B stands for the width, H stands for thickness, L stands for length, and R stands for the radius of curvature. And this is the formula for the gravitational potential energy. And we can see how the height is. And now I'm introducing the experiment. These are the materials we used. First we have to measure the Young's modulus, because the Young's modulus varies from each particle state. And we use this experiment to measure it. And the result of these Young's of particle A is 3.3 and power of 10, the scale, and for particle B, 2.12 to times 8 of the power of 10, the scale. And the upper picture is the setup, and the lower picture is we actually used tracker to collect data. And for the forward model, the height is collected when the highest point of each particle state. And for the reverse model, we choose the highest point of each time. And we choose the time when the particle sticks left the table to calculate the wave velocity. First we change the Young's modulus from particle A and particle B. Then we change the arrangement of particles when the distance of two particle sticks nearby is 4 centimeters. The radius of curvature is 16.38. And when the distance is 3 centimeters, the radius of curvature is 14.04. And third, we change the length of the particle chain. And we try 20, 30, 40, and 50 particle sticks. Then for the forward model, this is the result when we change the Young's modulus. And the wave velocity is only related to the energy, so it is positive correlated to the Young's modulus. And for the height, it is also positive correlated to the Young's modulus. And for the arrangement of popsicles, in the theory, we believe that this number should be bigger than this one, but we can see that this is actually smaller because we think that there's actually 2.5 centimeters aside for this one, and it will they need to turn more angle when they leave the table, so it has a bigger wave velocity. And for this, what's special is that the popsicle sticks will rotate and crush into each other, so they will be in groups. And the theoretical result is 32 and 42. And the result in the experiment is 30 and 40. That is the same as the theory. And for the length, since the energy will be sent to the next popsicle stick, because this is a forward model, so it doesn't actually affect the result. So the wave velocity for these three are the same. And for the height, it's the same because it isn't sent to the next popsicle stick. So the length won't affect the energy and won't affect the height. And now I'm introducing the result for the reverse model. First is the wave velocity when there's different Young's modulus. But for this one, it is actually opposite from the theory. Because there's 2.5 centimeters aside, so they need to turn more, and the wave velocity will be bigger. And for the height, the rate of the rate of rising is bigger when the Young's modulus is bigger because the energy is bigger. For the arrangement of particle states, it also doesn't conform with the theoretical model, also because the 2.5 centimeters aside. And for the height, it is correlated to the energy, which is correlated to the arrangement of particles. And for length, since the energy is sent to the next particle state, so the bigger the length, the bigger the wave velocity. And also the same for the height. Because the energy is bigger, the height is bigger. The rate of rising is bigger. Because the energy will be sent, so the height will be bigger and bigger. And for conclusion, first we investigated a phenomenon which elastic potential energy will turn into gravitational potential energy, and rotational energy can be negative. And then we made a theoretical model and found that there's actually forward and reverse, two kinds of models, and they have different kinds of results. Then we did three experiments according to the theory. First we did Young's modulus and the arrangement of popsicles, because it affects the elastic potential energy, which affects the result. Then we changed the length because it's different in a forward model and a reverse model. And the result from the theory and the result from the experiment is actually similar. So we can prove the theory. And these are the results of the experiment. For these four, the energy is positively related to the results. These are the charts we used before, and these four are positively related to the result. And these three doesn't conform to the theoretical result because the 2.5 centimeters aside. For these two, it doesn't affect because the energy isn't sent to the next particle state. And these two are affect because it is actually sent to the next particle state. And for this one, it should be affected by like those three, but the energy is much bigger, so it is same as the energy in the theory, because it affects more. Thank you.
Reporter, you have 2 minutes to question the opponent, you have 2 minutes to question the reporter. Please start your discussion. Opponent, you have 3 minutes to prepare your statement and argument.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. opponent, please, opponent, please take the floor. And you have maximum 4 minutes to make your statement. And then you can discuss with the reporter.
Place it is, so we can see the slope is the wave velocity.
is the positive six, and for the reverse model, because it is higher and higher, so we don't need to know how big is each positive six is. So we prefer to pick the highest point of each time. So at this time is this spot, and when it comes over, it is at this spot and this spot. So we just choose these points and see the rate of rising. For this one, you can see that this popsicle is under this popsicle, and for this popsicle is under this popsicle, so it's opposite.
Maybe it will affect, but it doesn't really
change the result. This affects maybe a little bit, but it doesn't really change
Let's move to the next stage. And opponent, you could use 1 minute to summarize the discussion. Do you want to do that?
Of the, I think the force will increase.
of altitude, it affects the height of the ball. So the bigger or smaller?
When the angle gets smaller, the velocity
please take the floor and start your presentation.
When the angle becomes smaller, it will become faster and higher.
But okay, so our instrument shows at the small angle it will be faster and the height will be lower. At the big angle it will be slower and higher. So we think the reason is the force, if the angle change the force and the displacement of the particles will not be parallel. So the work is not the same. And the force also a change because of the distance of the particles will change the electricity of the particles and the force will change. Okay, so next is a max height and velocity. With quantity, there will be no velocity, max velocity, and no max height. But we think that it won't be no max, it will be a max when the energy transfers and so energy transfer and energy assume became the same and you will have the max height and the max velocity. So it won't be no max height and no max velocity.
Okay, let's move on to the next stage. Reporter, please do your concluding remark.
For the opponent, they said that they asked some technical questions, like unit and whether experimental methods, like placement of obstacle states, are controlled. And they are actually controlled in our experiments. And structure of devices, the forward and reverse, and the normal forces analyzed. We believe that the normal forces doesn't affect the result, or maybe just affects a little bit, because both the forward model and the reverse model won't touch the table when they are released. And for the reviewer, the experiments on angles, the max height and max velocity. For the angle, we didn't say that it doesn't affect the result. It affects the result because it changed the radius of curvature. But there are more than one way to change the radius of curvature. We didn't change it by changing the angles. We actually changed it by changing the arrangement of popsicle sticks. And for the max height, it doesn't matter because we're looking at the rate of rising. So it's not important to see what's the highest point of the line. Like you won't want to know how what's the number for the line in the wave velocity. For the max height, the longer chain leads to a longer velocity.
And thanks to the opponent and reviewer for the great discussion and review. For next stage, the question of jewelry.
Middle part of the chain.
Yeah, I have a question for over you. The first from the reporter. Which parameters affect the height of the wave most, and why?
The height of the wave is changed by the elasticity. It's changed by the elastic potential energy.
Mm-hmm.
And from the formula, we can see that the Young's modulus and the gradient of curvature changes it. But for the Young's modulus, it varies a lot from different kind of popsicle sticks.
Mm-hmm.
Like it is 30 times bigger or something like that. But for the radius of curvature, it's only for 16 and 14, which doesn't change it a lot in the result. So,
mm-hmm.
And in the result, you also can see that what the one that changes most is in the Young's modulus experiment.
Okay. So opponent, what do you think? Which parameter affect the height of the wave most?
I think it's so many reasons, and maybe it's angles and the
angle.
Because I didn't do the Young's modulus,
okay.
I did the other changes, so I think it's the angles or the distance between them.
Okay. And
in my opinion, I think it's a material, and in the same material, I think the thickness of the particles. Because
mm-hmm.
in the same arrangement, if your particle is thicker, the amount of the band will be bigger too. And when it is it's thicker, and the Young's modulus will be bigger too. So it will change the energy it create. And you will transfer more, so you will be more velocity and higher.
So you see the material property.
Yeah, and sickness.
Sickness,
yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
So, any question from you? Do we have a further question? So,
no problem.
So now it's our scoring time.
Mm-hmm.
We have some.
Mm-hmm.
7, 7, 5, 6, 8.
Mm-hmm.
The score for opponent.
Mm-hmm.
5, 4, 4, 5, 4. Last one, the score for a reviewer. 7, 7, 4, 6, 6. Do we have any comments from the jury?
4, 3, 3. Yeah, getting better. Right? You're talking a lot, okay? Keep going.
Okay, thanks everyone for the second round, and we will take a 10 minute break. Assessed. So, every team, please write down the name of your representative on the platform. At the same time, record you have 5 minutes to prepare.
Thank you. 一下我前一场的成绩。嗯、
你前一场的成绩可以。
我想要记录，记录英语。
Reporter, please take the floor and start your presentation.
Yeah.
engineer crystallized metallic. We think in this experiment, crystal-like structure means that the particle arrange order, and in the 2D crystal structure, and we only have there have the bra and hexagon. And in this experiment, because of the shape of the things we check, we can only see the square and hexagon in the crystal structure. And the crystal is the source between the crystal and non-crystal. And this structure is older but not have symmetry like this. And it's our experiment. We have the bigger systems and 40 by 21 centimeters passive box and airsoft pellet and our cell phone, and we use the cell phone is HTC Desire Chiba. and the marshal and the measure. And first we using at the level to check the box is horizontal. And we take a picture which is the same size as the box. And we draw a mark scale that you need. And we arrange the particles closely under the mark scale. And we let the particles get older. And we using the same frequency shrinking 15 minutes and take picture every 5 minutes. And it's the FB laser. Experiment 1, we change the number of the particles per unit area. And it's our control variables. And we change, we have some wrong. Our density is the 32 over 12 and 32 over 16 and 32 over the 20 and 32 over the 24. And the other dependent variable is the number of the crystal-like structure. And it's our result. And it's the time and the and we and the density is 12, it means the 32 over 12 the crystal structure number, and it's 16. And it's 14, it's 24, it's 24 and it's all summarized. And we found so we count the change in the end and the beginning. And if there's 600 Hz and 800 Hz. Yes. And it's all summarized. And crystal light structures number more and more along this line. And the number of crystal light structures greater the general is the Huygens most and except the 800 Hz. And rectangle is unstable and difficult to generate. And it's our result. And if the Huygens number in the 200 Hz and 400 Hz and 600 Hz and 800 Hz, then it's square and it's rectangle. And the summarize and the Huygens number is the 600 Hz bigger than 200 Hz bigger than 400 Hz bigger than 800 Hz. And the spirit generation monster is 800 Hz and 800 Hz is bigger than 600 Hz and bigger than 200 Hz and bigger than 400 Hz. And the Huygens number expects the number of all crystal light structures to match. And it's the summarized and the average. The summarized is the 200 Hz. It's Huygens and square and the Huygens number and is 200 Hz. And it's 400 Hz and it's 600 Hz and it's 800 Hz. And it's the average. And that means 200 Hz has the and it's summarized and the number of crystal light structure is 600 Hz bigger than 200 Hz bigger than 800 Hz and bigger than 400 Hz. And it's our reference.
Opponent, you can question the reporter for 2 minutes.
Okay, so first, can you go through your result of the first experiment?
Please start the discussion.
Hold on, you have 3 minutes to prepare. You can have 3 minutes. Please touch the floor. You have maximum 4 minutes to make your statement, and then you can discuss with the report.
Okay, so we have some things to discuss about the experiment. First is the setup, like whether the using the phone for the has the accuracy, and also your frequency check. Like, is when you put it through the phone, you set it up on the phone. Like, is the box going at the same frequency? Does any other thing affect it? Also, like, the crystal structure, like, you can't see any experimental video. So, like, how? What do you see? Like, how do you know, like, it's a square, it's a hexagon, it's a pentagon? And, like, the shape control. Like, what is your definition for, like, the crystal? And how do you count it? And the data explanation, because it goes up and down. Like, there's no order. Like, you just go, certain frequency is higher, certain frequency is lower. Like, what's the explanation?
There have their same frequency.
So like you think it has the same frequency. So how do you know it has the same frequency? You measure it later on. Like how do you know it has the same frequency?
Sorry, I have not measured it, but
like, so you're not sure if it has the same frequency.
I guess because the sound trigger on this bar, and so it's the same sound, so it wouldn't have
so
any.
So how do you know it's the same sound? Like, so you
because
guess.
Because I only have a sound to hit.
So you just guess.
Yes, I guess.
Okay. And next is how did you count the pentagon, the hexagon, the sphere, and like how are you sure that that's the crystal like structure that you want?
In our experiment, we have the hexagon and the sphere have the too much the number of the crystal structure, and the hexagon is like this. And in this circle, there were a triangle, and it but sometimes.
Okay. So what if they're all bunched up? Like what structure is that now?
Sorry.
If they're all bunched up, what structure do you count that?
Here they come, and we think it's a structure like, and sometimes. Okay.
What if you have this, and it's all around?
Yes.
What structure is it?
Sorry, I don't understand your meaning.
You have all the balls bunched up.
Yes.
So what structure do you count that? Do you count that as one triangle or how many triangles? Or
sorry.
How many
hexagons?
What about the square of the
hexagon?
Well, like, what if they're all bunched up? What is that? If this appears, what is that?
It's a crystal-like structure.
Yeah.
Like these are more filled.
It's like if they're all bunched up. What do you count that in your experiment?
Anyone?
So do you mean if it's together there's two?
Yes.
So if you have that, you count that as two?
No. And
in your graph for your experiment results. Like for these, are these the ones that are new, or are they just ones that?
It's old and new.
Just the new ones.
No, just new ones. Is there when the time is there 5 minutes? How much the crystal that structure in this box?
Okay, so a quick overview of what we have up here now. For their experiment setups, they didn't check whether the box has the same frequency from what they put out. So maybe a higher frequency it degrades more, maybe lower frequency degrades less, or maybe the opposite. So we don't know. Maybe the frequency has an actual change depending on the box. And for the crystalline structure, depending on how they put it, it might set up different. It might appear to have a different number for every single experiment. And for their adding up, when they add up every single one, things might be new or like added new, or things might stay the same. And then they also average it. Like maybe the time makes it more, and then you're averaging less you might were averaging what they have, because maybe over time the crystallite structure adds up, maybe, and then they're averaging their things together on the experiment. And your result. What is your explanation for this?
We think.
What causes this?
We think there is a frequency can make the crystal like structure is easier to generate. So, and we think maybe has the contact with the air. Particles is that the same speech shapes frequency, natural frequency.
So then what do you think the next one is?
Sorry, I can't very well to explain this, but yes, I think there is a frequency you must fit to form the crystal-like structure.
So, do you think 600 is more fit and then 400 is least?
Yes.
So why? Like, what affects this? Because if you say then 600 is most fit and then 200 and then 800 is more fit, so what is the relation between this that causes this?
Because the frequency can observe the spot I found in my experiment. And so the maybe in six frequency there will have the two more choice to pump and stop and become the crystal like structure. But in the 800 when it was too much pump and can't make it become the last
driver.
And 400.
And 400. Wait, 600 is just enough. 800 is too much. What about
400? Sorry?
If 600 is just enough, 800 is too much. Then what about 400?
It's a balance. I think it's
so
a
then why is 400 at the end? Like 200. It is way less than just enough. Why?
I will say it's a crystal-like structure. And Yes.
So what about pentagon? Like, can you draw it and tell me what kind of orientation would you think that it is pentagon? Like, how is it arranged? The arrange of the clouds that you would think is pentagon. How is it pentagon?
There's many the square is like this, and there is a square, but in the hexagon we can see there is a.
So what about pentagon?
I think, and there is.
So when you're counting it, how do you see this?
I don't know how to let you understand that. I can see that. There is
so you just count out here. You think it's a pentagon?
Yeah.
And just a quick overview of what we have after that. The result was 600 hertz is a number of crystallized structure, and 600 hertz is more than 200 hertz, and more than 800 hertz, and more than 400 hertz. But their summary was based on their observation, which is 600 is most. But they guessed and think that 600 is more because the amount of frequency is just enough, and then 800 is too much, and then the other two are too less. But they don't have any experiment data to support this claim. They only put their summary of their observation. And then for their crystallized structure, even though you can probably count the hexagon pretty easily and probably square it much easier, but the pentagon, like, you don't normally see 72 degrees, 36 degrees that easily in life, and so they counted a feeling, which is not that optimal for being for an experiment. Thank you. For their pros, they have a lot of data for all their experiments, and they have a detailed equipment. But their cons was, like, it's not smooth enough to understand. Like, it just goes straight to it. It's kind of hard to understand. And they have bad coloring in the background and the front. And there's no experimental photo in the PET or an experimental video, which makes it harder to understand. And it didn't really explain the data, like they just showed it and it didn't explain. And they haven't a clear outline, like we just saw and then we tried to understand. And then there is Chinese in the PPT in an English presentation. Thank you.
Then you pause it, please stand by your team. And the viewer, you can question the reporter and the viewer.
Okay, quick question here first. I'm sorry. What is the corresponding crystallization? And to the opponent, to the person. What causes crystallization? What causes crystallization? What is your theory about crystallization?
Sorry, that is my fault, but I am very hard to explain the theory.
Okay, one. What do you think causes crystallization in the first place? Hello? Excuse me. What do you think is the force causing crystallization?
We think it is simply chance.
Okay. Now, so, next. Do you think there would be mass crystallization, or would the crystallization saturate to the opponent too?
Sorry, can you speak slowly?
Okay, so, do you think there would be a max area or number of crystals? And to the opponent too. Do you think there would be a max number of crystals?
Well, there obviously will, because there are a limited number of clouds.
Okay.
Sorry, I can't understand your question.
So, what decides the shape of a crystal? And why do you think it is important to the problem state?
Because in your big factor, the crystal-like structure will.
The opponent too.
There were very big confident and there was some
okay.
on there.
So,
yes.
Hexagon is long. So, do you think that the shape of the crystal is important to the problem statement?
Yes.
Okay. Now, next. Well, you said that you use a container to put in the pellets, right? So I want to ask a hypothetical question. What would happen if I removed the boundaries and I had an infinite amount of particles spread across? Do you think crystals would still be formed and why? And to the opponent too. Okay, so they're putting their pellets in a fixed area with boundaries. So do you think, firstly, this would affect crystallization?
Yes.
Okay, and what would happen hypothetically if we take away the boundaries and have this uniform spread of pellets over a whole lot of space?
The shape of the wave would be different for the frequency.
Okay, and well, do you? Sorry, is this the last question?
Yeah, basically, if you figure out the facts, and
there will be
a strength under
the
system, so it will be
more. Please start your You can start your presentation.
Okay, so good evening to our fellow contestants and the jury. I'm the reviewer from Team Hemta, and I'm here to review on problem number 11, flat self-assembly. So let's take a quick look at the problem statement again. Okay, just as we read through the problem statement, we would get a few key points. Firstly, is that the problem statement asks us why the particles would sometimes form crystals and sometimes not. Next is how different number densities and other parameters affect the results. Okay, so let's get a quick review of what the report is. So in the observation part, they gave us a clear problem statement and the introduction of crystal. However, there is no observation video, and in the theory part, well, they did not give us a qualitative or quantitative theory for crystallization. And next part in the setup, they gave a thorough explanation of the setup and used camera analyzation, and they had a thoughtful setup indeed. And well, the phone vibration might not be that accurate. We'll talk about that later. In the experiment parts, they controlled B and the shape of B frequency and the independent B is sort of missing, and the reactive B and the number of crystals. Okay, they have a clear presentation of the data, but they did not explain independent variables. And in the conclusion, they gave a summary and did not explain why they used those regression lines to fit their results. Okay, so about the opponents, they have some pros about, they talk about the technical points about the experiments and whether it is accurate or not. And ask for clear definitions of crystal numbers and related variables, which I think is very good because we need to know about more about the definitions of crystal. However, I think they do not have that good prioritization. Like they press too much for experimental technicalities, and they don't talk about theory that much. Right. So here's the question. First, the opponent asks how they know and the box vibrates at the same frequency and if they did any measurements. Well, the reporter basically said they don't think it will be different and they think their method is legit. Well, I agree that the method is legit, but it is always a good idea to check. Okay, so now next is the definition of crystals, where the reporter answered that they answer by drawing particle position diagram and other ways of explaining their definition. Well, I believe that we need a clear definition for the term crystallization, such as an area instead of the crystal count, because it's hard to define once you get a huge bunch, as the opponent mentioned. Next, well, about the vibration and energy. Well, here, the reporter says the natural frequency will probably affect the pattern and the number of crystals, and that too much vibration would dislodge the pattern. Well, this may be a point, but I believe that the most prominent factor would actually be having higher frequency causing more collisions, as I'll explain later in our additional points. So I think that mostly at higher frequencies, we have more crystals. Okay, so there are a few additional points that I would like to suggest that the reporter and the opponent could discuss or do more experiments on. First, well, we should determine what the force that's or the reason that's causing crystallization. This is probably the most important thing from our problem state. Well, I believe personally that this is particle contact force, and that when particles contact and group together, they will eventually have less displacement because of the boundaries caused by other particles. Next is the saturation of crystallization. Well, yes, you did your experiments on how the crystal some experiments on how the crystals form and the numbers as they grow, but there should be some max crystal count. As the one mentioned, it might be because of the number of pellets to limit it, or there might be other possibilities. Okay. Next is maybe we should do experiments on the surface, because larger friction in our own experiments causes slower crystallization but higher stability, and the boundary effects should be discussed. I personally believe that when we take out the boundaries, the crystals would be formed slower because you don't have the boundary as a place to grow your crystals from at first, and the crystals would form in the middle, yet still form. Okay, and maybe if they lack a theory, they could discuss the reason of crystallization through an analogy, like for example, the Helmholtz-free energy. Okay, thank you.
Because you can have permission to do your computing
initial condition. The initial condition
I think either one for you to answer. Mm-hmm.
The starting condition. The starting condition.
Yeah, the initial condition that will impact the final convergence.
We think that if the pellets are closer to where the, because there are waves, the way of sound, like the standing waves, like there are points where they converge. Like if the pellets are closer to that point, like it would be easier to converge. So if like there are no pellets near that, then it would be take longer to converge. If they are closer to it, then maybe it's
earlier.
Yeah. Like maybe this is
the I want to clarify this one. Your initial condition means placement or other parameters?
First, the placement of those particles.
Okay. I agree with the proponent on the placement of particles, though I think it would be a better idea to try to take out the effects of standing waves caused by the vibration. So I do not think in a hypothetically perfect system that there should be standing waves in the system. So there would not be that much of an effect from the initial placement. So I think under parameters such as the density and the density of how many particles are placed in the area would be more dominant.
The reviewer, you asked very good questions to the recorded opponent. What is the force causing crystallizations? Do you have any theoretical model and to try to explain your data?
Okay, two parts to answer that. First, the force causing it here would actually be contact force because they're going to prevent the contact force between particles is going to prevent them from greater displacement. And as the second part about the model, I think we use the almost free energy equation to give the sense of the model. Well, and if you want, you want to discuss what the equation is based.
So, do you consider the interaction between the particle and the subsurface?
Well, mostly the surface would be giving a vibration as in their experience horizontally. So, I think it would be more like an initial start to make particles collide instead of being the main cause of the phenomenon.
You want more questions?
Yeah, we still have time. I have a question. Could you go to your table and your plot? You have three tables, three features. Anyone is okay. Okay, this one. Okay, in your table, the first column is the time. It's the time for a vibration. 0 minute, 5 minute, 10 minutes.
Yes.
Okay, the time. Okay. So. For zero, a minute of the vibration, you already have one square.
Yes.
So okay. Quite interesting. And for this one, for a 0 minute vibration, you observe seven square crystal structures.
Because we measure this. Particle is older, so it has the transcube
become the
crystallized
structure. And you may find that 16
have more crystallized
structure is
because the
16
have more particles. So there
have
too many transcube.
So it's a scoring time. First, the score for a reporter. 6, 4, 5, 5, 4. And then
the score for opponents 7-6, 6-7, 7. Final score for reviewer 9-6, 9-8, 7.
Thank you, jury.
So, any comment from the jury?
After three rounds, everybody's really doing a good job. So I suggest everyone take a good rest, especially from Bali and Tainan, and don't go to the night market tonight. Take a rest if you go to night market tomorrow.
Okay, then our physical fight is over. So first, let's thank our lovely and admirable juries. Then, we can also thank ourselves for such an effort and all your teammates for the collaboration.